This is the Barry Richards Show, WBSM On Demand.
App.
Without further ado,
WBSM presents The Barry Richards Show, streaming live on WBSM.com and the WBSM app. Call 508-996-0500. Text us using app chat on the WBSM app. Now, The Barry Richards Show.
All right, welcome back to the program. It is 107. It is a Thursday afternoon. 508-996-0500 is our phone number. So the jury selection is in a recess right now for lunch in New York, and will resume fairly soon. A second juror has now been dismissed. These are the people that had been seated. I think there were seven. So now there are two dismissed as of today. Another 48 walked into the courtroom this morning, immediately dismissed because they could not be impartial in the view of the judge. So this is going to be a lengthy process, I think. So we'll keep posted on that. I don't know, do you think it's possible to seat a jury that is going to be acceptable to both sides in this? Boy, this is going to be a process. They said it was going to take 2 weeks. I don't know, it may take more than that. In the meantime, Attorney General Merrick Garland has been given a final warning to comply with a subpoena for the audio of President Joe Biden's interview with the special counselor Robert Hur. Remember, Hur was appointed by Merrick Garland to investigate all of the documents that Joe Biden had stored illegally in, I believe, eight different locations, including his garage behind the Corvette, remember? If Garland does not comply, he will face contempt of Congress proceedings. House Oversight Committee Chairman James Comer, Republican of Kentucky, and Judiciary Committee Chair Jim Jordan, Republican of Ohio, have instructed Garland that this is his last chance. Biden's Justice Department previously offered to provide the transcript of Hur's interview with Biden's book ghostwriter, Mark Swanitzer. But Republicans say Biden's transcript and audio were needed to conduct oversight of the president's classified document scandal. And they wrote, on February 27th, 2024, the Committee on the Judiciary and the Committee on the Oversight and Accountability issued subpoenas to you for a narrow and specific set of material in the Department of Justice's possession relating to Special Counsel Robert K. Hur's investigation of President Joe Biden's willful mishandling of classified documents. Your response to the subpoena remains inadequate, suggesting that you are withholding records for partisan purposes and to avoid political embarrassment for President Biden. If the department continues to withhold materials responsive to the committee's subpoenas, namely the audio recordings of Special Counsel Hur's interviews with President Biden and Mr. Swanitzer, we will have no choice but to invoke contempt of Congress proceedings. They continue. That means they could throw his butt in jail. Now, to avoid this, the committee expects you to produce all responsive materials no later than 12 p.m. on April 25th. During the president's interview with Hur, Biden experienced mental lapses and poor memory at least seven times, according to a transcript of the sessions, the interview sessions. Hur's investigation, which concluded in February, found Biden, quote, willfully retained classified documents but declined to prosecute him, citing insufficient evidence. Hur characterized Biden as an elderly man with a poor memory. About one-third of Democrats doubt Biden's mental fitness, according to a Harvard-Harris survey. Another poll revealed 82% of Americans harbor concern about the physical and mental health of Joe Biden. So what's interesting about all of this is essentially what the special prosecutor, Hur, found was that Joe Biden is just an old sympathetic geezer who would never be found guilty and was willfully, quote unquote, willfully in violation of the law, but might have a tough time defending himself because of his mental capacity. So Garland, who hired her to conduct this investigation, followed the recommendation and said, well, we're not going to prosecute because, you know, this guy's two Fritos short of a full bag. But then to confuse matters even further and contradict his own prosecutor, Garland yesterday testified that Biden has, quote, no impairment after being pressed by a Republican lawmaker about the findings of special counsel Herr's report on Biden's improper handling of classified documents. Garland, speaking to Representative Ben Klein of Virginia during a House Appropriations Committee hearing on the Justice Department's fiscal year 2025 budget request, said, quote, I have seen the president effectively guide the members of the department of his cabinet and his military. Garland declined to comment when asked if Klein, asked by Klein if he agreed with Herr's characterization that Biden is a, quote, sympathetic, well-meaning elderly man with a poor memory, saying, quote, I have said before, and I will say again with respect to the report, that it is improper for the attorney general to editorialize. The president has no impairment. I don't know how many ways I can say this. I have complete confidence in the president, and I reject your characterization, Garland also stated. Herr said in his report that he would bring no criminal charges against the president after a months-long investigation into improper retention of classified documents related to national security. So which one is it? So, you know, Attorney General Garland can certainly say to Herr, well, look, yeah, as I just told members of the Appropriations Committee, Biden's spot on. His mind is great. It's clear. He's in charge and everything else. So I reject your characterization that he's too senile to test, you know, to be prosecuted. So if you are telling me that he willfully violated the law, I'm going to have to prosecute. Because so listen, you catch the contradictions here? When we talk about a two-tiered system of justice in this country, I mean, you look at what's going on with Donald Trump, right? You've got Donald Trump right now is being held against his will. He's almost a political prisoner in this courtroom, right? The judge tells him, you show up to court or you're going to jail, which means he can't be out on the campaign trail. The judge, who, by the way, is a Democrat who's donated considerable amounts of money to Democrat candidates, including Joe Biden. His daughter was involved in the Joe Biden-Kamala Harris campaign. Even though you've got two different statements signed by Stormy Daniels saying there was never an affair, that Trump and I met for a couple of publicity things. He was a perfect gentleman. And none of the stories about hush money, none of the stories about a sexual relationship or any kind of relationship for that matter are true. Two signed statements by Stormy Daniels. Misdemeanor charges being brought by the district attorney that had been rejected by federal and state authorities 8 years ago as being unprosecutable. But the district attorney is going forward with a, by the statute of limitations ran out on the misdemeanor, so he upped them to felonies so that he could bring a case against Trump. But yet, on the other hand, you've got a special prosecutor that was appointed by Biden's attorney general, Merrick Garland, who says, yeah, this guy willfully violated the law. Biden willfully violated the law, but he's too senile to prosecute. Garland says, well, I accept that report. But then he goes before Congress, yes, and he says Biden is as fit as a fiddle. Nothing wrong with him. He's not impaired in any way. So if that's the case, why is Biden not being prosecuted? See what I mean about the two separate tiers of justice here? And we've seen this from all the way from the start. Now, when they found Joe Biden's documents in his house behind the Corvette and seven other places, we didn't see SWAT teams going in, searching Jill Biden's underwear drawer like we saw in Mar-a-Lago, what they did to Melania Trump in a humiliating fashion and all. We didn't see any of that stuff. Hillary Clinton, 33,000 emails destroyed, computers destroyed, raspberries destroyed, hammered. Remember, bleach bit, all that kind of stuff. We never saw that. Nobody went through Hillary's underwear drawer, perish the thought. Nobody went through Bill's underwear drawer either. Two separate tiers of justice. Meanwhile, Donald Trump is being held hostage in a New York courtroom. I think even the most ardent Trump hater out there can see this. You may not like Trump, which is fine. You may hate everything about him. You might hate his hair. You might hate his tan. You might hate his anything about him, which is fine. This is America. God bless you. You have a right to do that. You may think Joe Biden's a better president than Donald Trump. That's fine, too. But you cannot deny that there is two separate tiers of justice, that this is a complete unfair process that we are watching play out in front of us. The Justice Department is weaponized against Donald Trump. You have to see that. You have to admit it, if you're being honest. Quick break. We're coming back for your call. Stay tuned. 508-996-05.
Always dancing down the street with his way blue eyes. Every new boy that you meet doesn't know the real surprise.
Here she comes again
when she's dancing beneath the starry sky.
Twenty-four now on a Thursday afternoon, 508-996-0500. Used to love the Cars. Every now and then I remember the Cars. Oh, my God, I got to throw some Cars on. But they were great. I loved them. A good sound back then. So welcome back to the program. We're talking a little bit about the Trump trial, waiting for it to resume in New York. Merrick Garland, and whether Merrick Garland is going to be held in contempt of Congress for refusing to hand over the audio tapes. There's a difference between, Merrick Garland says, well, I'll give you the transcripts. And members of Congress say, no, we want the audio tape. There's a big difference between, and you know this yourself, right? How many times have you sat down to write an email or a text message and you look at it and you say, boy, this sounds like it's pretty harsh, or this doesn't sound... It doesn't sound quite the same way when you write something, or it might sound benign when you write it, but then when you speak it, you hear it differently, comes across differently, right? So there's a big difference between, you know, Biden's words on paper and actually hearing him addressing the questions that he's asked by the investigators. So they want the tape. The tape exists, so they have a right to it. That's public property. And so I don't see any reason why Merrick Garland is holding on to that. Keep in mind, too, Merrick Garland's history with Joe Biden is such that if you remember, Merrick Garland had been nominated for the Supreme Court, and the Republicans, led by Mitch McConnell in the Senate, held up that nomination and left it open so that after the election and after Trump beat Hillary Clinton, Trump was able to name somebody to the Supreme Court. And it obviously was not Merrick Garland. Thank God, right? And so as soon as Biden came in, Biden appointed Merrick Garland his attorney general. So he kind of saved his reputation a little bit and gave him a government job that he didn't get otherwise, and put him on the payroll. So Merrick Garland has a vested interest in taking care of Joe Biden. He doesn't want to release that tape. He doesn't want those tapes to be heard by congressional investigators, because it's going to make Joe Biden sound dumb as a donut, as he is. And again, you know, you see words on a paper. It's not quite the same as actually hearing, a rambling crazy Uncle Joe. Like yesterday when he was talking about how his uncle was... captured during World War II in Guinea and eaten. I mean, the stuff this guy comes out with is absolutely Whew. Mind-blowing. Yeah, I hadn't heard about this. Biden was in Pittsburgh yesterday. By the way, that the press is making very little of the fact that he is being hounded by pro-Hamas supporters. Everywhere he goes, he's being hounded. And but in Pittsburgh yesterday, he told members of the United Steelworkers Union that his uncle vanished in an area of New Guinea that was populated with cannibals after his plane crashed during World War II, and they ate him. They ate his uncle. The Defense POWMIA accounting agency, though, has a different version of what happened to Biden's uncle. The site said on May 14th, 1944, an airplane carrying a crew of three and one passenger identified as Finnegan, which would have been Joe Biden's uncle. At least they had the same name, Finnegan. Left Mamotte Airfield on Los Negros Islands for a courier flight to New Guinea. For unknown reasons, this plane was forced to ditch in the ocean off the north coast of New Guinea, the report reads. Both engines failed at low altitude, and the aircraft's nose hit the water hard. The report also said three men failed to emerge from the sinking wreck and were lost in the crash, while one crew member survived and was rescued by a barge. Finnegan has not been associated with any of the remains recovered from the area after the war and is still not accounted for, according to the report. They hate Uncle Joe. Hey, my uncle. What was his name? What was his Finnegan? What is his first name here? Uncle Joe. Was it Uncle Joe? She's my best friend's girlfriend. Ambrose. Ambrose Finnegan. They ate Uncle Ambrose. Uncle Ambrose. Ambrose Finnegan. How the hell do you get a name like Ambrose? Your last name's Finnegan. Electric vehicle sales plunging across Europe last month. Is demand drying up despite the EU's push to ban petrol and diesel vehicles by the middle of the next decade? The Daily Telegraph reports sales of battery-powered cars dropped by 11.3% as demand in Germany, Europe's largest economy, plunged by 28.9%, according to the European Automobile Manufacturers Association. Volkswagen, Mercedes-Benz, Tesla, all recording falling electric vehicle sales in the first 3 months of this year. Not just limited to Europe. According to reporter Simon Kent, Tesla, for example, saw its delivery slump for the first quarter of the year, missing forecasts, and a sign that even price cuts haven't been able to stave off increasing consumer skepticism about the long-term EV market. There was a great story today in the Boston Herald. I don't know if you saw it. It's on their digital newspaper online. I'm not sure if it made it into the hard copy. It probably did. But this is about, this is interesting. It's a story that was written by Lance Reynolds, Boston Herald. It says firefighters across Massachusetts are facing the nearly impossible task of extinguishing lithium-ion battery fires much more often, according to new state data showing that such blazes have spiked sharply in the past half year. I'm going to read this entire article to you. It's not that long, but it has some very important information that you need to pay attention to. Even if you don't own an electric car, this isn't solely about electric cars. Okay, the State Department of Fire Service created a checklist last October for local fire departments to use to track the number of fires that are caused by lithium-ion batteries, which power large devices like electric vehicles and smaller items like smartphones and e-cigarettes. There are lithium-ion batteries in your smartphone, and in your e-cigarette. Now, think about this for a moment. This scared the bejesus out of me this morning as I'm sitting at my desk in my office down the hall here reading this story and going through it. And I'm thinking, how many of these things have I left plugged in routinely all the time while I'm out of the house? I've got a computer on my desk in my office at home. I've got an iPad that's on the charger right now. My earbuds are on the charger right now. What else have I got on the charger? I probably have a set of hearing phones, earphones. My wife works professionally with all of that electronic stuff. She's got video, all kinds of digital stuff. She's a professional drone pilot. And so she's got all that, plus computers, everything plugged in at home. All of these things, chargers, all run with these batteries. Next to my bed, I've got... And you know what? You leave these things plugged in. You take, for example, your Apple Watch off of the battery charger, and the charger stays plugged in. You just take your watch, put it on, and walk away, right? And all of these chargers are plugged in all the time while you're not home. Department of Fire Services created a checklist last October for local departments to use to track the number of fires caused by lithium-ion batteries, which power large devices like electric vehicles and smaller items like smartphones and e-cigarettes. You leave your phone plugged in sometimes right next to your bed at night, right? Or maybe in the other room. So far, the forum has helped 38 cities and towns in Massachusetts identify 50 lithium-ion battery fires in the past 6 months. More than double the annual average detected by a national fire data reporting system, according to West State Fire Marshal John M. Devine. The Massachusetts Fire Incident Reporting System, a state-level tool that mirrors and feeds into the national reporting system, recorded an average of 19.4 lithium-ion battery fires per year from 2019 to 2020. 23. The increase since last fall could be due to the growing number of consumer devices powered by these batteries, increased attention by local fire investigators, or other factors, Devine said. The Massachusetts State Police Fire and Explosion Investigation Unit immediately started using the form, which is optional for local fire departments to gather information when responding to fires involving lithium ion batteries, make and model of the device, purchase history, and whether it was charging at the time of the blaze. Brockton Deputy Chief Kevin Galligan told the Boston Herald that he believes in the past firefighters blamed the device for the fire and not the battery. That's changed now, he says. He says, and I quote him, personally, to a point where almost every fire I go to now, I'm assuming I'll be dealing with lithium-ion batteries, he said. Whether they are the cause of the fire or they were involved in the fire, it's almost as if we can't get away from them at this point. So whether the battery erupts and causes a fire in your home or your garage or whatever, or whether it becomes involved in that a fire that starts elsewhere, it's a problem. 9 of the 50 fires that DFS reported involved battery-powered scooters, e-bikes, and hoverboards. 8 involved laptops, and another eight involved cell phones, tablets, or similar devices. Power tools were also involved in 6 fires. The device's charging status could be determined in 41 of the 50 fires. The device's charging status could be determined in 41 of the 50 fires. Surprisingly, 56% of these devices were not charging at the time of the incident, according to officials. So they weren't even on the charger. They were just sitting there and burst into flames. Lithium-ion battery fires are, quote, much more intense than a fire caused by careless disposal of a cigarette or cooking, Galligan said. Smaller devices that use lithium-ion batteries, like a drill or a laptop, are relatively easy to extinguish, but it is a different story for larger items like vehicles, he said. They're nearly impossible to extinguish, and you use thousands of gallons of water trying to cool the batteries to prevent it spreading from battery to battery, Galligan said. Once a battery is in thermal runaway, There's nearly nothing you can do to stop that single cell. The only thing we could do is try to cool the batteries around it to stop the spread. Even after the fire is extinguished, there is still more work for firefighters as they have to make sure all batteries are removed from the scene so they don't cause a rekindle, Galligan said. New York City has made national headlines with the number of incidents there soaring well over 200, injuring more than 100 people and killing 14 after a series of fires involving faulty e-bikes, batteries, including a blaze that claimed four lives last June. Officials announced they were receiving a $25 million emergency grant from the federal government to fund sources of, fund scores of charging stations citywide. It's a significant challenge for the fire service, Galligan said. We are constantly coming up against whether the next problem is or whatever the next problem is, and it does require a lot of training and additional equipment to address this. But it is something that we have to face because the lithium-ion batteries are not going away. Scary stuff. So you are being forced to buy battery-powered cars, but are being told, don't put them in your garage because these batteries can just burst into flames. There goes your garage. There goes your house. And they pour thousands of gallons of water on these things, and they can't put the fires out. All they can try to do is cool down the batteries next to it so the fire doesn't spread. It is dangerous. They emit dangerous chemicals. And this is just the cars. Again, scooters. And the things that you smoke with there, the vaping things, and your cell phone, your batteries in your watch. Isn't this the stuff they're putting in the windmills too? Hey, this is safer than dirtling for oil, right? Quick break, 508-996-0500. We're ready. Welcome back, 1:43 on a Thursday afternoon. You know, I love this time of year because I sit here in the window and I watch all the boats going by being pulled on trucks, you know, where they're heading, right? They're heading into the water, and that's always good stuff, right? Springtime is here. What a beautiful, today's kind of a crappy day out, but the last few days I've really enjoyed driving to work, and I kind of take the back roads to get in most times. And, you know, the colors of springtime. Spring's not my favorite season. Summer is. But I like spring and I like fall too. And what I like about spring because it finally says to me, yes, the world is coming out of hibernation and things are growing again. There's life. And the last few days have been so beautiful driving to work through the back roads and seeing all the purples and the pinks and the yellows and the whites and all the different colors and the bright green, of course. All the colors out there and the sunshine in the sky. And you can always tell when it's spring and summer because the sun's a little higher and the light's a little bit different. So it gives you reason for optimism and puts a little bounce in your step as you're moving along. So you need days like today, though. You need a little bit of rain here and there in order to help these things to grow. But it certainly is pretty out there with all of the different trees and flowers and lawns blossoming. Anyway, there's going to be some big news happening later on today. Members of the Kennedy family are going to appear as a huge group today to endorse President Biden. Members of the Kennedy clan. Now, this is amazing to me because, look, you know, I don't, Ted Kennedy's been gone for a while now. But I interviewed in my long storied career Ted Kennedy many times. Patrick Kennedy many times, and he was a member of the Rhode Island legislature, and my beat used to be the Rhode Island State House. I know something about the Kennedys. I think the Kennedys would be considered maybe moderate by today's standards. They certainly would not be in the same left. And we thought they were left back then, but I don't think they would be in the same league with Biden and his people to the left. So it's amazing that they're going to come out and endorse Biden today. But I guess what are their options? They can't endorse Trump, right? And because they'd have their Kennedy button taken away from them, their Kennedy card. They lose their Kennedy card if they endorse Trump. But they don't want to endorse one of their own. And this is the first time I can ever remember in my many years of being a Kennedy watcher, the Kennedy clan coming out against one of their own. It's a public display of support that reveals a weakness that Democrats privately acknowledge. Biden is likely more at risk from Robert F. Kennedy Jr.'s third-party challenge than Trump is. So the Kennedys are turning on Robert F. Kennedy Jr. and to try to save Joe Biden. Axios reports with a substantial number of voters telling pollsters they are dissatisfied with both Biden and Trump. Democrats are increasingly petrified that a Kennedy name on the ballot will throw the election to Trump. RFK Jr.'s sister, Kerry Kennedy, will invoke the legacy of her slain father, former Attorney General Robert F. Kennedy, as well as that of her uncles, John F. Kennedy and Ted Kennedy. I can only imagine how Donald Trump's outrageous lies and behavior would have horrified my father, she will say, according to a prepared remark shared with Axios. President Biden has been a champion for all the rights and freedoms that my father and uncles stood for, she will say, joined by more than a dozen members of the Kennedy clan. So this is going to be interesting. Biden will be introduced by Joe Kennedy III, a former member of Congress from Massachusetts, who serves as the president's special envoy in Northern Ireland. After Biden's remarks, Kennedy family members will knock on doors and make calls on behalf of the Biden campaign. Somebody named Kennedy knocks on your door this afternoon. Don't open it! My goodness. 508-996-0500. You're next in WBSM. Good afternoon.
Hey, Barry, you know, like I've told you in the past, I was a Democrat for many years. And one reason that I love Democrats is because they fight. They'll punch you, they'll scratch you, and they fight for what they believe in, unlike the Republicans, right? Here we are. They bring the impeachment to the Senate, right?
Yeah.
And here comes Schumer and says, nope, it's not going to happen. And here the Republicans look like idiots. If you reverse that, when the Congress impeached Trump twice, Mitchell would say, well, we have to follow the rules of the Senate and the impeachment will continue, right? Mm. And you have Schumer here saying no. So Mitchell could have done the same thing and denied that impeachment twice, but he didn't. And that's what I mean about Republicans. You know, the Democrats always teach them lessons. They're teaching them about the Constitution. The Republicans are crying now, oh, it's unconstitutional, right? But it's dead.
Well, the Democrats have no choice but to stop this. I mean, they would anyway, but they have no choice to stop this because imagine if there was a trial, right? Imagine if there really was a trial and we spent the next 2, 3, 4, 5 weeks, maybe even longer, with impeachment hearings on television every day, talking about how bad the Biden administration's border is and immigration policies are and so on and so forth, that would be devastating to the Biden campaign. So the Democrats have to stop this from happening. I agree with your point about the Republicans. They're a bunch of weak-kneed scaredy cats that can't organize. They're fighting themselves right now over the speaker and so on and so forth while they should be banding together. But, I mean, the Democrats also, if Trump is smart, and if the Republican National Committee is smart, they would make an issue of this. You know, look at this. You know, they protect. All you got to do is look around you and see how bad the immigrant problem is in this country right now, 67% of Massachusetts residents say it's either chaotic or a very serious issue. That's Massachusetts, 67%. So there's a lot of people concerned about this. So if you see the Democrats neatly sweeping this impeachment thing under the rug, that's just one more case of justice being weaponized, right? They're taking care of their own. Meanwhile, Donald Trump is being locked in a courtroom, threatened with jail if he leaves.
Yeah, I just, you know, I just wish it would have been the Republicans who would have denied that the trial when Trump was impeached. You know what I mean? The Democrats are always teaching the Republicans a lesson.
Yeah.
You know, they're like children in the classroom, and the Democrats are the teachers. And now the Republicans saying, wait a minute, we could have stopped the impeachment from Trump. We never know we can do that. And this is what I'm trying to say, is that the Democrats always outsmart these Republicans, you know?
Yeah. I'm watching live on television in front of me right now. There is a an anti-Israel protest happening at Columbia University in New York. And the police have moved in. And I can see one, two, three, four police buses. And protesters are being handcuffed and taken into the buses. So New York has apparently decided enough is enough with this, and they're not going to tolerate this anymore. So it's going to be interesting to see. If you remember, what was it, Monday or Tuesday, there were the protests all across the country. They shut down the Golden Gate Bridge. Midtown Manhattan was shut down and places like that. So I think people are losing tolerance for this. And so hopefully this will be a trend that we'll see now reflected in other cities as well.
Yeah, they should take them to Hamas.
Take them to Gaza. There you go. Here's your one-way ticket to Gaza.
You know, live under what you believe for 6 months. Yeah, what will you think about it?
Yeah, right? Thank you, my friend. Appreciate it. 508-996-0500 is the number. And we're going to go to break here. And I just want to remind you that my good friends at Duncan Hearing Healthcare take care of me so well. And they'll take care of you as well. Duncan Hearing Healthcare in the hearing care business. They are the experts in our region, Fall River, Hyannis. And now their new location in Dartmouth. They were in Dartmouth before on Route 6. They've now moved further east on Route 6. They're at 49 State Road now, right next to Not Your Ordinary Joe's. And it's Suite 201 in the Pequot building. And they're also in Falmouth as well, trusted by thousands of patients, including me. Duncan Hearing Healthcare knows that your ability to communicate is critical to having a happy lifestyle. Make an appointment today with any of their four offices and experience why they have a 5-star rating on Yelp, Facebook, and Google. Learn more at DuncanHearing.com, and please tell them Barry sent you. Duncan Hearing Healthcare, they are aces in my book, and you will think so too. We're back out. To the program. Time for news. And again, the police are detaining anti-Israel protesters outside of Columbia University in New York. I can see on the TV screen in front of me four police buses, and police are there, and they are rounding up the folks who are demonstrating. I'm not quite sure what they were doing to warrant arrest, but probably obstructing traffic or doing something. But they are being arrested, and this seems to be a new tact by the police. And in any event, we'll let you know if there's anything newsworthy that comes out of this. I don't know whether ABC will cover it coming up at the top of the hour, but